This evening on The Rock Newman Show, he's a former civil rights leader and community activist with a progressive agenda for Maryland. Free college, legal marijuana, and a higher minimum wage. Meet Ben Jealous, the Democratic nominee for governor of Maryland. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. He's the former chairman of the NAACP. He's been an educator and a Rhodes Scholar, but right now he wants to be the next governor of Maryland, and he tells us why in his own words.
This is about opportunity. It's not about doing better in another generation. We can do better for this generation. The most important thing the next governor can do is to make sure that any Marylander who wants a job can find one. There's absolutely no reason that we have to accept continuation of the scourge of mass incarceration and undereducation or unemployment. Let's get back to the values that are best about our families. Let's make sure that you can aspire to go to college. Let's build a movement. What this campaign is about is whether we're willing to dream again.
Ben Jealous, thank you.
It's good to see you, Rob.
Thanks for having the Rock Newman Show today.
Thank you, brother.
Man, you have a rip-roaring schedule, and we're really thankful that you took some time out to come in here to talk to our audience. Let me ask you a question.
Sure.
There was a debate. September 24th?
Yep.
Is that going to be the only debate?
I hope not. I challenged this governor to five. Said we would do it all through October. Yeah. Traditionally, that's when the debates are. That's when voters are paying the most attention.
Right.
The governor has refused to even discuss October. He gave us a couple of dates in September. One of those worked, so we grabbed it. But I've said to him, look, we got 4 full weeks in October. We need to debate every week. The people of the state deserved it for us to have a real conversation so they understand there's a real choice.
And the reaction has been?
He's the incumbent. He realizes he has a lot to lose by debating me, and quite frankly, after the first one we had, it was pretty widely recognized that he didn't fare so well. So he has been very reluctant so far to actually say that he would debate me again.
The previous administration, Obama administration, Joe Biden came out and endorsed you a couple of months ago and just recently President Obama gave you an endorsement.
Yes.
I want to ask you two things. One, what does that mean? What does that mean to you?
It means a lot to me personally. I helped do a lot to get Obama in office the first time, and then as president of the NAACP, my biggest focus in 2012 was turning out 1.2 million unlikely voters to seal the deal the second time. But I think it's also important to the people of the state because it reminds us that it wasn't long ago that we had more hope. Mm. It wasn't long ago that we felt like we were moving forward. And his endorsement gives a lot of people assurance that what I'm about is getting us moving forward again, changing our state for the better.
Are you sure it wasn't like 40 or 50 years ago when we had hope?
Well, it was like 4,000 tweets from Donald Trump ago.
Okay, let me jump in on your platform. First up on your platform is education.
Yes.
K through 12.
Yep.
Tell us, Maryland has been ranked over the years, number one in some categories, and has generally thought to be flourishing in education.
Yeah.
It has There's been a drop. Tell us what you think is wrong and what you're going to do to make it right.
The number one problem we have in the state right now is that the governor has no plan to get us back to first. We were first in the country for 5 years. Yeah. Number one in the country for 5 years under Martin O'Malley. Mm-hmm. Larry Hogan comes in office, we fall. We've fallen in the national rankings every year he's been in office. And what has he done? He sent millions of dollars from the general fund, not to our public schools that the state says that it underfunds by $2 billion a year. The state's own consultants say that. No, he sent them to private schools in the form of vouchers. And so I put a plan on the table to show how we get back to being number one in the country. It starts with making sure that we have full day universal pre-K, so every kid shows up to kindergarten ready to learn. We know that every dollar that we invest in early childhood education saves dollars up for the state down the line in a whole range of things, including, frankly, it saves incarceration costs later. Yeah. But that plan, at the end of that plan, is making sure every child graduates ready for a career. When I was 20, I was living in my aunt's basement in Suitland, and you know, I had to catch the bus to work in D.C. Uh-huh. Well, I just got my 19-year-old nephew out of my basement. Yeah. It felt like graduation day for me. It reacquainted me with the fact that it's easy to feel like there's a shortage of good jobs for our kids. Uh-huh. And then you look around, you realize all the friends you have to move who moved to this region for somewhere else for good jobs. And it's more that we have a shortage of our kids that we train for the good jobs that we have. In Maryland, Rock, get this, we have shortages of first responders. We have shortages of teachers, of nurses, of computer programmers, the entire building trades, truckers, et cetera. And so what I've said is that we will make sure that all through high school and even through community college, and we'll make sure that they can go through grade 14 for free, kids are being trained for a career as well as to go further in college if they wish.
And you, which leads me right into my next question here. You have made a big deal.
Yeah.
Very unapologetic for saying you want to have a major impact on ending the student debt crisis. Okay. Now, Governor Hogan says that your plan for helping to reduce and ultimately end the student debt crisis is tied to ending mass incarceration.
Yeah.
And his charge is that that makes Maryland less safe. I'd like for you to talk to us about, one, how you go about ending the student debt crisis,
sure,
minimizing and ending it, and if in fact indeed that is tied to mass incarceration, and what your plan is.
Sure. Governor Hogan is a Republican, and he does what Republicans do. He tries to scare people. I mean, from Willie Horton to Donald Trump, we've seen these attack ads from Republicans saying, oh, the Democrat in the race is going to make us less safe. What he's trying to cover over, and I say this as somebody who's had two family members shot in Maryland in the last 10 years, is that murders are up statewide in Maryland. When you take Baltimore City out of the equation, they're up 34% on his watch. He has no plan to make us safer. And when you include the city, they're up more than 50%. And so I take umbrage, quite frankly, at his attack ads. What am I talking about? I'm talking about reducing our recidivism rate, making sure that when people come home from prison, they come home ready to be productively involved in our society, able to find a job, trained for a job, more literate, less addicted, so they don't go right back to prison. And when you do that, if we just say brought our recidivism rate from like 40% down to say 32%, well, in 4 years, our prison system would shrink about 30%. And why is that important? It's important because it would save us $660 million a year. If we simply brought Maryland's incarceration rate to that of New Jersey, which is no great leader in human rights, we would save $660 million a year, and we could send that money back to our public universities. Now, why is that so important? Follow me here for a second. Late 1950s, my granddad goes to the University of Maryland School of Law for 1 year to become a probation officer. It's what lifted our family out of poverty in West Baltimore.
Okay.
Tuition was $200. By 1970, tuition, University of Maryland School of Law, $400. Mm. Today, if it kept up with inflation, $2,600. It's actually over $31,000. What happened in between mass incarceration? When you, starting in about 1970, as incarceration rates start ticking up, states spend more and more on incarceration. They spend less and less on public higher education. Student debt goes up. Student default rate goes up. What comes down? the number of young people starting new businesses. Why? Because they're layered in debt. And so what I've said is we've got to bend the arc back. We got to start investing more and more in our love for our kids and less in our fear of somebody else's kids. We got to break this logic where politicians always ask what it costs when it comes to educate more children, but never ask what it costs when it comes to incarcerate somebody else's kids. The president of Penn State was the one who really broke it down for me, and he said it quite simply. I said, what's your greatest leadership challenge? This is years ago. He said, every year I go to the state capitol, a little nod to Biggie Smalls. He said, every year I go to the state capitol, it keeps so much more money from going to the state pen, so just a little more can come to Penn State. Mm-hmm. For now more than two generations, our states have had an addiction to incarceration. It is costing all of us, including it's driven up public university tuition as states have underfunded public higher education in order to have funds for incarceration.
There's someone on the staff here, mm-hmm. back in the control room, that comes down and helps us to put this show together from Baltimore.
Yeah.
And just prior to me coming to sit here today, yeah. kind of pulled me aside and said, are you familiar that just recently, as our educational scores goes down, the graduation rates are declining, that there was just recently a super prison built, and then some youth facility.
Yeah, I mean, think about this, right? The governor cut $68 million from Baltimore City Schools first year, and then turned around and spent $30 million building a new youth prison. And that's the type of cynicism that we have to move beyond. For too long, we've allowed zip codes to have tyranny over children's opportunity.
What does that mean?
What I mean is, my mom sued Western High School for Girls in Baltimore when she was 12, in approximately 1952, so that she could desegregate it in 1955. And we knew then that what part of town you came from mm-hmm. defined what opportunities you were going to have. Mm-hmm. Well, now that we've ended segregation by law, we have we have de facto segregation. Black folks in many areas more segregated than we were 50, 60 years ago, especially states north of the Mason-Dixon and south of the Mason-Dixon, in many areas like Baltimore, just as segregated. And what it's really about is, frankly, segregation by class. That you can be in Baltimore City or you can be in Western Maryland and find neighbors just entirely poor. Poor black folks, poor white folks. And if you're born in that zip code, chances are you will live a shorter life, you will be less educated, and there's a greater propensity that you will go to prison. And so what we've said is that we will make sure that every school is properly funded. Again, the state of Maryland, its own consultants say, is underfunding our schools by $2 billion. And you better believe that has a disproportionate impact on children in zip codes where families have lower income.
When you talk about the lower income and you talk about the zip codes, there is something that is a scourge that is in much of the nation, and Maryland has not been spared at all. And one thing that doesn't discriminate,
yes,
is opioids.
Amen.
And there has been a rise. When you go past Maryland State Police barracks,
yes,
you see the car deaths out there, yeah, highway fatalities. You also see some statistics about opioid,
yes,
deaths. And it has continued to accelerate.
Yeah.
What do you attribute that to, one, and how would you stem the tide?
It's a serious issue. Opioid deaths in Maryland are up 160% in the last 4 years. This governor ran for office saying he would declare a state of emergency on day one, and then he did that on day one of his third year in office. He waited 730 days before he declared the state of emergency, and thousands of our neighbors died. I don't know anybody in Maryland who hasn't been impacted. I had a 13-year-old girl in the upper middle class family's backyard in the Eastern Shore. Blonde ponytail, tennis racket in her hand. I said, what do you want the next governor to know? And then she went to talk to me about the fact she had buried three classmates in the last 12 months because they became addicted to pills. I've had a pastor, inner city Baltimore, went to high school, grew up there locally, said he fears that his next high school reunion will be at the cemetery. He has buried so many of his own high school classmates. He's in his 40s. And so, what we need to do is to deal with this addiction crisis as the public health emergency that it is. What does that mean? It means that we need 10 crisis response centers statewide, one every corner of the state. That's what leaders in the state legislature originally proposed. The governor ended up only funding one. was in Baltimore City. Well, we need him on the Eastern Shore. We need him in Southern Maryland. We need him in Western Maryland. We need him in Montgomery County. We need him in Prince George's County. We don't just need one in Baltimore. One. Two, even that one, they are rationing the life-saving drug naloxone, which is outrageous. The doctors say, we need more. Mm-hmm. The Republicans say, oh, if we do that, people will use more opioids. No, no, we'll save more lives. And we need to stop that foolishness, but they're always trying to scare people. We need to make sure that we have rehab on demand. Now, how are we gonna pay for it?
Which was gonna be my question.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So, one, we just have to reprioritize what we're doing. This governor has pretended like incarceration is as important as rehabilitation mm-hmm. and fighting addiction, and it's just not. Mm-hmm. Addicts need to go to rehab, and we need to make that our first priority. Second, we need to actually sue the pharmaceutical companies and get us to pay us back for all the millions we're spending dealing with a crisis that they've largely created. At the end of the day, if we had a natural disaster that was killing as many people as this is, we'd be all over it. Yeah. And we've got to treat this like the unnatural disaster that it is.
In answering the earlier question, you mentioned the Eastern Shore a couple of times.
Yeah.
I was over on the Eastern yep. Shore on the Choptank River
yeah.
Just this
fishing
past,
or?
Just past weekend. I'm joining some friends.
Okay.
And I saw a lot of Hogan Rutherford signs.
Sure.
I also saw signs for Andy Harris.
Yeah.
And for those who might not know him, I'll probably let you yeah. characterize him more, but you know, he's been in the news as of late, saying some rather, one, he's self-proclaimed Trump conservative,
yeah.
if I have that right, yeah. and he said some rather outrageous things. He's also tried to introduce some legislation that prevents D.C. Residents from being able to use marijuana for medicinal purposes.
Yeah.
Purposes. Here's a question I have, because there was an argument taking place at the event that I attended
yeah.
where they were talking about, obviously him saying he's a Trump Republican,
yeah.
but also that he was tied to Governor Hogan.
Yeah.
And I'd like to get your characterization of this a congressperson, Andy Harris from Maryland, who just doesn't appear to be a Maryland kind of guy. I mean, if I hear some of the things that come from him, from a congressman from Mississippi, or Gomer from Texas, or someone from Louisiana, but he just doesn't seem to be a Maryland kind of guy.
Well, the Maryland Republican Party actually has a number of extremists in it. I mean, if you look at Grasso up in Anne Arundel County, or Peruca, Peruca is a member of the League of the South, which is a neo-secessionist organization. It's a white supremacist organization.
Mm-hmm.
Grasso is a known Islamophobe that said some horrible things. These are leaders in the Republican Party in the state. And it's just a reminder, you know, that Republican leaders can be problematic anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And in that respect, Andy Harris, unfortunately, is in good company. And Hogan is supporting a number of these fellas. Harris, not only has he attacked the rights of the people of D.C., and he seems to be opposed to the folks here actually having proper representation,
mm-hmm.
Something which, you know, I have been a lifelong champion for D.C. voting rights and for proper representation, having two senators, the congressperson having a vote. But he's also made himself an obstacle to installing wind turbines off the Eastern Shore. And that ultimately hurts people all across the state. I mean, one, you know, this is how we will reduce our carbon footprint and help fight climate change. In Maryland, if we move to 100% clean and renewable energy, 65% of that will need to come from wind, and disproportionately off the coast of the Eastern Shore off of Ocean City.
Mm-hmm.
Two, this is how we create factory jobs in places like Dundalk and South Baltimore again.
Mm-hmm.
We should be building the turbines there, floating them down the bay, installing them off the Eastern Shore. But this is who Larry Hogan supports. And quite frankly, I mean, you can go up to Pennsylvania, look at the Republican candidate for governor there, true Tea Party Republican Republican, the right wing of the right wing. Larry Hogan's been up there championing him. It should remind people that Larry Hogan is very much in the model of Chris Christie. Chris Christie was very affable his first term, and then his second term, when he was focused on running for president and not for re-election, took a hard right turn. And you can already see that in many of Larry Hogan's endorsements in the state and outside of the state.
So let me ask you, as the leader of the Republican Party in Maryland, the governor,
yeah,
having these kind of what you refer to as extremists,
yeah,
what would you want Governor Hogan to do to demonstrate the highest level of leadership to speak to address those individuals and some of their policies, their platform, and their values?
The governor of Maryland in these times are defined by Donald Trump's politics of divide and conquer, has to make our state a model for how we move forward despite Donald Trump's leadership. I have repeatedly stood up to Donald Trump. Our governor, on the other hand, has repeatedly aided and abetted him. He tries to distance himself from a little bit, but if you get right down to it, he's enforcing Donald Trump's immigration policy. He sent a helicopter to the border to do it, gave local police and sheriffs the right to become deputies of ICE, which makes all of us less safe because they become more distracted, and immigrants stop giving them information they need to solve serious crimes. The governor has stood silent on, first on Pruitt, more recently on Kavanaugh. He unilaterally ruled out a state investigation. Then he said, well, maybe we should have a delay for an FBI, but we don't need a delay on Kavanaugh. We know enough. We need to be done with Kavanaugh. The governor gave Betsy DeVos a tour of our state, then said, parroting her policies, millions of dollars to, millions more dollars to private schools in the form of vouchers.
If I could stop you there.
Yeah. And
so gave a tour of the state. Probably any governor would do that.
Not Betsy DeVos. I, for one, wouldn't.
You wouldn't?
No, absolutely not. This is the most anti-public education Secretary of Education in American history. Mm-hmm. She is an advocate of bringing guns into our schools. She is not an example for our children. And this is what I'm talking about, mm-hmm. is that we have an opportunity in our state to make our state a model for how we move forward when Donald Trump's trying to take us backwards. And this governor has refused. What I would do as governor is to make sure that we move as quickly as possible, 100% reliance on clean and renewable energy, and create thousands of new jobs, that we really push past this 29% goal that they put for women and people of color business owners to get contracts. I mean, think about that, Rock. Women are 53% of the state. People of color are 48% of the state. Together, we're about 75% of the state. And they've told us to throw a party if we ever get 29% of the contracts. Well, the reality is that, and I know this as an investor, my firm's invested in 150 startups. 68% of them have a black, Latino, or female founder, and our returns are much better than average because we're a meritocracy. The state of Maryland, on the other hand, our economy's stuck. If we had the job growth of Virginia, we have 40,000 more jobs right now, and Virginia's job growth is lower than the national average. And so we're being held back in part by the fact that our economy is not a meritocracy, certainly when it comes to government contracting. And so it's about, fundamentally, being governor is about leading, about having the courage to lead, having the courage of your convictions, not, frankly, cowering the shadow of President Trump. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm going to jump here to your criminal justice position.
Sure.
Governor Hogan again has said that that is reckless, it's dangerous, and it makes Maryland less safe. I think we have
this video. Is what Republicans do. This is how they scare people.
Under the previous administration, gangs and criminals were running the entire state prison system. We said we were going to come in and clean up the entire operation. It resulted in 139 indictments of correctional officers, other people working in the correctional facilities, and the people they were coordinating with in the private sector. We decided that we needed to make sure we had background checks and lie detectors and make sure that we weren't hiring more criminals into the system, and that's what we've done. It's made it more difficult to fill these positions. We need to pay these positions better. What we've done to help recruit, we put signing bonuses. We gave them, take care of their student debt up to $20,000. We've been having a major marketing campaign to address them. We've been hiring more people. But under my opponent's plan, His plan, it's the only place he wants to cut. He wants to fire thousands of correctional officers, public safety officers, and put thousands of dangerous criminals out on the streets. Mr. Jealous might not be aware of what's been happening here in Maryland, but we actually passed the most intensive criminal justice reform act in a generation and have been praised by almost every single elected Democrat in Maryland. We've reduced our prison population more than the other 49 states. We're number one in America in reducing the prison population. We've reduced it by 9%. We've gotten rid of all the people that were simple possession, misdemeanors, and other things. He now wants to take another 30% of the violent criminals. These are murderers and rapists and repeat violent offenders, and put them back onto the streets. It just is absolutely not. Some of your proposals are reckless, but this one is downright dangerous. And it doesn't make any sense whatsoever.
You can't be governor if you want to do that.
I mean, this is the problem with Larry Hogan. He's never read one of my plans. I actually said to him at that debate, please just go to benjealous.com. It's all there. I won't go to benjealous.com.
Yeah, I actually saw that.
well, don't talk about what you won't read, governor. You know, and I've spent my life fighting mass incarceration. Our prison system is a bloated south of the Mason-Dixon line prison system. Our rate is about 40%, 30-40% higher than the state of New Jersey. We cut ours by 30%. We can get closer to that. We do that, we save $660 million a year, we can fund our schools. How do you do that? Again, you cut recidivism. How do you cut recidivism? You make sure that people spend their time in prison productively, training for jobs that actually exist on the outside. There's a lot of folks behind bars that can't read. You make sure that they come back ready to read. You legalize cannabis for adult use. The governor opposes that. I support it. It would reduce our prison population further. The governor is trying to use the old Willie Horton playbook, the old Donald Trump playbook, of making these outlandish claims that simply aren't true. And as a murder victim family member who's had two family members shot in Maryland in the last 10 years, I take great offense at his suggestion I would let violent criminals out early. No one's talking about that. What we're talking about is we have a bloated criminal justice system that is not working properly, and we need to make it work more efficiently. Now, let me also say one other thing. This governor has put our corrections officers at great risk. We have folks who say that sometimes they're on the yard, there's one guard and 200 inmates. That's terrifying. Mm-hmm. I've met with officers who have had their knees busted, their skulls fractured, and the governor has forced them to work. They are now being conscripted for mandatory overtime. I was at ECI, a correction institution on the Eastern Shore, and both the inmates were protesting and the correction officers' families. As president of the NAACP, I've never saw an institution where you had both sets of protests going on simultaneously. That's the pressure cooker he has created. And with all due respect, this is not because he cleaned up corruption. It's because he's been completely incompetent in actually managing our government. He mentions now, because he's running for office, they need a raise. They have needed a raise. I was about to use Ebonics for a second. They've been done needed a raise for a long time now. and you go talk to the officers, they'll tell you they are eight steps behind. So that means that they're being paid about 20% less than they should. Well, that makes it harder to recruit people. So with all due respect, this governor, whether it's our corrections institutions, whether it's our schools, whether it's the environmental enforcement, where we have the lowest level enforcement in 20 years, he has proven to be incompetent in actually managing our government well.
And there are whispers and sometimes shouts on your policy for Medicare for all.
Yes.
That, you know, you've gone past Bernie Sanders, and you've gone, I mean, you've really gone socialist. Yeah. You damn near communist. Now,
and what do they call Martin Luther King? They called him a communist.
Point taken.
And what do they call FDR? They called him a communist. Yeah. And what do they call Bill Clinton? Because of health care, they called him a socialist. And what do they call Obama? They called him a socialist. In other words, our greatest leaders. have always had these horrible names thrown at them, these silly names thrown at them by Republicans who are protecting big pharmaceutical companies, who are protecting big insurance companies. Who's funding the attack ads calling me these names? The pharmaceutical companies. What's the difference between me and Larry Hogan? He takes money from the pharmaceutical companies. I'm willing to take on the pharmaceutical companies.
So your Medicare for All policy,
yeah.
A study was done. You know, when you drill down on it, you see that study that is often referred came out of government. So one has to look at that with some suspicion. Nevertheless, there are those who stand by its findings that say that your plan for Medicare for All, in order to fund it, you would have to place a 10% tax above what is taxed now on all businesses, and for every man, woman, and child in the state of Maryland, it would be $2,800, and so that plan would cost $24 billion a year. Where are you gonna get that money?
Again, these are the Republican attack points, and if you read the report tells you that actually they couldn't calculate the cost of the current system. And it turns out the current system costs about the same. So all they're saying is that providing health care for the people of Maryland, however you do it, costs, you know, $22, $24 billion. You can do it through the private system, or you can do it in a Medicare for All system. Most expensive option, everybody agrees, every study that's been done, most expensive option is the status quo. Healthcare costs in Maryland under Larry Hogan are up 120%. What pushed me to Medicare for All? Like many small business people in the state, I found my business and the businesses that I was trying to grow being choked by high healthcare costs. I tried to move a factory, Rock, from northern Canada to South Baltimore. It would have brought 300 jobs, good paying jobs with healthcare, to a block, three quarters of which is a public housing project. The deal fell apart because healthcare costs under Larry Hogan keep surging. Literally, the entrepreneur said to me, I've noticed the healthcare costs have gone up in your state the last 2 years. Do you expect them to go up this year too? I said, yeah, probably. He said, well, then I can't afford the next cost structure. I can only afford the current one. And they went up 50% under the next open enrollment period. And so the question is, how do you get this under control? The way that you get it under control is you leverage the buying power of the people of the state to get us a better deal. This is what Jeff Bezos and Warren Buffett want to do for their
leverage
companies.
Leverage the buying power of the people of the state, and you do that how?
You require the pharmaceutical companies, in the short term, we'll require the pharmaceutical companies to allow us to re-import from Canada. Once we have Medicare for All, mm-hmm. we can purchase for the whole state at once. Mm-hmm. Right now, we're being purchased insurance company by insurance company, mm-hmm. and we're being charged multiples of what people, let's say, in Canada are being charged.
Uh-huh.
Second, you bring down the cost of managing the system. Medicare, the overhead, the cost of managing the system is 3%. Currently in Maryland, companies like Blue Cross Blue Shield, CareFirst, it's 19%.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to remember, when you move to Medicare, when you move to Medicare for All, you stop paying expensive premiums. You stop paying deductibles. You stop paying co-pays. Right now, healthcare in Maryland is the number one cause of personal bankruptcy. It's choking our small businesses. The costs are up 120% in 4 years. We have 350,000 people who don't have it. And I've sat with white collar professionals who have lost loved ones. In one case, it's a 52-year-old woman who was a psychologist who died because she lost her health insurance. She had a gap in her employment. She began rationing her medication. We have a full-on crisis. Our healthcare system is failing. I've been endorsed by the nurses and the teachers and business people all across the state because I have a plan to fix it.
So here's something I'd like you to take a stab at. Because
yeah.
it's got to be something that is somewhat vexing to you into,
sure.
into your campaign. Everybody should have health coverage to avoid a disaster. That's
yeah.
That's why you do it. That's why you
yeah.
get it, just in case. So, but people who need it the most are older. And Governor Hogan seems, if you are to believe polling, he polls right now, it's arguably he in most polling he has a double digit lead over
sure.
you. And amongst folks who are older, he has even a higher, a stronger lead. So what you are explaining of Medicare for all would most benefit those that are most supportive of him. How do you change that?
We gotta
How do you reach them and change that?
You change that through ads, you change it through organizers. I'm taking on a challenge here that no one in Maryland we can find the collective memory of the state has done, which is a Democrat coming through a crowded primary to take on an incumbent. Glendenning did the first part, O'Malley did the second part. We can't find anybody who's done both. Mm-hmm. And what that means is I'm still getting known in the state. 75% of voters know who I am, but 25% don't. And the way that you reach them is through advertising. And so we've been raising money, our ads are getting up. What we find is that when they hear our message, they disproportionately come to our side. And so my challenge in this general is very similar to what it was in the primary. You might recall, I lost every poll in the primary, and then I won the primary by 10 points. And I won 22 out of 24 counties. How did we do that?
That's my question.
Yeah. We did that by speaking to the issues that people are most concerned about, education, healthcare, jobs, standing up to Donald Trump, and then putting real plans on the table, building a bigger army of organizers than anybody else, and putting our message out there when it counts. And increasingly, folks are beginning to see our ads, and you're seeing that they're swinging our way. Governor Hogan, I think, knows better than anybody that where I'm at right now is exactly where he was at 4 years ago. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that that keeps him up at night.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned Canada.
Yep.
And I'm assuming that when you mentioned Canada, you talked about the ability to purchase prescription drugs.
Yes.
At a fraction of what it cost
here. Yep.
Share with us a little bit more, because some of my aunts and uncles take, you know, 8-10 pills a day.
And it impoverishes
them. And it is killing them. Yeah. It is taking away wealth that so many elderly have achieved over a lifetime of hard work.
People even get reverse mortgages.
Speak to that, because that's real personal.
It is. I mean, the chairman of my campaign is 80 years old. He's a graduate of Morgan State and the Wharton School of Business. His last job, washing dishes at the Horseshoe Casino. Mm. Why? For 10 an hour. Why? Because he could not afford his wife's pharmaceutical bill. This is real, and it's killing multi-generational wealth in our community. Yeah. You and I both know that. And so when you look, we're paying multiples of what they pay in Canada. Our states always have the right to re-import from Canada. We would need to pass legislation to do it. This governor has refused to do it. You go look at...
What's the justification for that?
It's getting a better deal. See...
No, I'm saying, what's the justification? What's the justification that the governor offers for not being able to purchase drugs that would serve the population in the state of Maryland for a fraction of the cost of what it currently is?
Preserving the status quo on pharmaceuticals is a morally bankrupt position. I have no idea what his justification could be. What I can tell you is this. If we're willing to stand up to the pharmaceutical companies, and this is why they're funding his campaign and the attack ads against me, we can pass legislation in the state very quickly that allows us to re-import from Canada. We do that, Rock, some drugs, the cost gets cut in half. Some pharmaceuticals, the cost gets cut by 80%. Mm-hmm. I had one woman testify that she had gone online and found in Canada she could literally buy her prescription for 1-2% of what it costs her here.
Yeah.
And so that's what I'm saying, is that being governor requires you to have courage, requires you to have a plan, and it requires you to be willing to take on these big corporations. I took a real risk in my campaign, kicking the hornet's nest and saying, we're going to take on the pharmaceutical company. They put millions of dollars in trying to stop my campaign. But you and I both know that when your family members are being impoverished by a series of corporations who are overcharging them, you have a moral responsibility. And when your neighbors and the people of the state, even more still, to stand up. And that's what we're doing in this campaign.
You have an initiative, Innovation Maryland, and you talk about, when I've heard you talk about that, you talk about that your experience as an investor is something that has prepared you and qualifies you to make innovation in the world of
business and job creation that would dramatically help lift Maryland across the board. Give me an example of the experience that you've had that gives you the know-how to do what you claim.
I've helped build at least 20 companies in the last 5 years, including some right in our state. One of those, for instance, it's a company called Emoca in Baltimore. What their product does is it allows people who are required by law to take certain medications to comply over their smartphone rather than have to go to a drop-in facility. What that means is they get to keep their job, because you got to go stand in line at the drop-in facility. You just miss 3 hours of work, and you have to do that every day. Oh, you just lost your job. Mm. Where did that technology come from? It came from researchers at Johns Hopkins. The entrepreneur came to Johns Hopkins and said, what research have your researchers created that I could take to market as a product? He found this one. He took it to market. The company's been growing leaps and bounds. Why is that important? The engine of the Silicon Valley is federally funded research. What the companies in Silicon Valley have done is figured out how to take that to take that research to market as products faster than anybody else. Mm-hmm. Maryland is number one in the country per capita destination for federal research dollars. Mm-hmm. And yet we lag in taking those ideas to market. Right now, the Maryland Department of Commerce has an Office of Tech Transfer, where these sorts of ideas, you work with entrepreneurs to bring them to market as product. Mm-hmm. I've said as governor, I'll bring it right into the governor's office. What we know is there's a little bit more intention can help you retain and grow more companies. I'm a mentor to startups through Johns Hopkins Accelerator. Several years ago, we were losing most of them to other states. Mm-hmm. The overwhelming majority is a Johns Hopkins faculty or student created a company. They would invariably move somewhere else to grow it. Now we keep most of those companies. What did we do differently? We organized the investment community. We created a closer relationship between our startup founders and area investors. As governor, I'll lead our state in doing that. It's already begun to bear fruit. In the middle of the primary, I brought the leaders of Google and their parent company, Alphabet, here to tour the state as a place for possible expansion. Now think about it for a second. There would be no Google without Maryland. Two founders, one of them, Sergey Brin, product of Prince George's County Public Schools. Mm-hmm. Father's a math professor at UMD, where Sergey attended for several years before founding his company. And so I simply said to them, look, if there'd be no Google without Maryland, why isn't there more Google in Maryland? Yeah. I said, well, how can you help us? Yeah. I said, well, what are your pain points? Number one, we're trying to build a more inclusive workforce. I said, well, Prince George's County alone has 17 times more black programmers than Silicon Valley, where you're headquartered. Not as a percentage, as a raw number. You have 1,000, we have more than 17,000. So why don't you come, and by the way, state of Maryland, our programmers in the state are almost 20% black. They said, we want to acquire more health companies. We have Hopkins and UMD. We have a lot of startups, let's talk. They said, we need a cybersecurity center of excellence. I said, we have NSA and Cyber Command. We have the workforce that you need. Let's talk. They said, we want to create a vocational pathway into programming because we have a 600,000 programmer shortage, and if we can only hire people with master's degrees, we're never going to meet it. This is in the Valley generally, but Google's a big piece of it. I said, well, we have some of the most innovative community colleges in the country, from Prince George's to Anne Arundel, all across the state, Baltimore County, Baltimore City. He said, great. You know, Montgomery County, we have a bounty of innovative community colleges. So we brought the community colleges, the universities, including HBCUs, to the table. We brought local entrepreneurs to the table. Now they're looking at Maryland as a place for expansion. We can sell Maryland on its strengths, but it means that you have to have a plan. And what's the difference between me and Larry Hogan? Can every governor do this? I mean, I guess if they were focused. Terry McAuliffe, who's endorsed my campaign, former governor of Virginia, mm-hmm. beat Larry Hogan in every tug of war over every company that was wanting to move to the region. I asked Terry why. What did he say? Plan beats no plan all day long. Larry Hogan never had a plan. Here's the thing. Larry Hogan barely picks up his phone. When Discovery Channel announced that they were leaving, part of the story that they gave was, this is kind of awkward because we, based in Maryland, acquired a company based in Tennessee. And now we're moving to Tennessee. First governor, by the way, in 30 years to lose a Fortune 500 company in Maryland because it acquired a company somewhere else. Sometimes we lose them because they get bought by a company somewhere else. But we've never had this happen. They said, well, why is that? He said, well, you know, we called the governor for 4 months. He never called us back. It took him 4 months to call us back. In the meantime, Tennessee was calling us every week. We only had four Fortune 500 companies in Maryland to start with. It's not hard when you only got four Fortune 500 companies to return their calls promptly.
Over the last several years, Baltimore has become a poster child for violence,
yeah,
murder, drugs, gangs. What, in your Great Cities initiative,
yes,
what is your plan to help? Let's just go right to Baltimore.
Yeah.
I mean, because if you can go to Baltimore, if you have a strategy to change what has been the demise of the quality of life in Baltimore, then obviously, if you have a plan that will work there, it'll, yes, work in the other cities in the state. What's the plan?
The plan is to make Baltimore once again in the top three health sciences industry regions in the country. It used to be, it no longer is. We still have Hopkins and UMD. We can get back there. Mm-hmm. The plan is to make Baltimore the capital of the green technology industry. That means creating even factory jobs to build turbines as we shift to clean energy. It's right in the center of the state. It's on the bay. There's a port there. There's railways there. We can get technologies all across the state. We need to build it in Baltimore. The plan with Baltimore is to make Baltimore a hub for highly talented, high-tech freelancers. The largest onshoring operation of computer programmers in the country is in Baltimore. What does that mean? Well, people know what offshoring is. There's a boiler room of computer programmers in India or Nigeria, and the jobs that are there used to be in the U.S. Well, this reverses that and brings it back. And here's the incredible thing. That company is called Catalyte. 26% of their programmers are black, and they train people in-house without any requirement of having a degree.
How do you do that? How do you, though, compete with the cheap labor abroad?
You do things better. A company like Catalyte, they found even though paying good wages, I mean, they have apprentice programmers, they start out at $36,000 a year after 16 weeks of free training. A lot of these guys, I kid you not, and these gals, former forklift operators. Mm-hmm. But they have they do a personality test, mm-hmm, and they think like programmers, and then they train them to work like programmers. Mm-hmm. In 3 years, Rock, they're making six figures. Mm-hmm. And yet they're so much more efficient than folks overseas, and working with them is so much easier that pound for pound major companies have found that Catalyte is just simply a cheaper, better option all in. So by really building on the strengths of Baltimore as a center of health excellence, as the biggest city in a state that yearns to be a leader in clean and renewable energy, and as a place where we're already able to attract freelancers, in part because it's more affordable than Philly or New York or other cities in the region, we can bring a lot of jobs back. At the same time, we've got to make sure that our young people are trained for the jobs that exist. Mm-hmm. And so you've got to create a relationship between industry and our public education system where we're forecasting these are the jobs that we're going to have 5 years, 10 years, and we're training young people to meet them. Again, we have shortages right now, even beyond high tech, of teachers, of first responders. I mean, think about it. You say to like a five-year-old, what do you want to be? Half of them want to be a teacher or a police officer or a firefighter, mm-hmm, and we have shortages. Mm-hmm. That's on us. Mm-hmm. We can fix that. And it's also about, frankly, creating apprenticeship programs. When you have the most educated workforce in the country, you will disproportionately find you are attracting great companies to come. We have to focus on making sure that Baltimore becomes a great destination for the most innovative companies in the country, but also becomes known as a region with the most highly educated workforce. We can do that, but it means that we have to make major investments in education, and fundamentally that's what my campaign's about.
Quality of life issues very much is affected by how communities are policed.
Yes.
Talk to me about how you would go about reforming policing throughout the state. That's a challenge.
Again, so on that website that Larry Hogan will never go to, benjealous.com, there's actually a plan for this. And I was the only person in the primary who put out such a plan. Where it comes from for me is I teach criminal justice reform, part because I'm inspired by my own family. My family's been in law enforcement in Maryland for over half a century. Mm. My grandfather was a probation officer for 30 years. And just this morning, once again, cousins of mine picked up their badge and their gun and they went to work. What we know, and again, coming from a law enforcement family, is that so-called high crime neighborhoods are also high rate of victimization neighborhoods. They're the neighborhoods that actually most rely on services from the police and are most eager to have a good relationship. And yet they're also the neighborhoods where the relationship with the police is often most strained. Mm-hmm. And so we've got to change that relationship. How do we do that? Well, we need to recruit more officers from the very communities that they police. That's part of why we want to build an apprenticeship program from high schools straight into the cadet program and ultimately into the force. We need to change how we recruit officers. We can use personality tests to actually weed out the personalities that are most likely to be abusive or unnecessarily violent. We aren't doing that now. We can, we should. We have to train them differently. The best practices in the world are that you train officers every 6 months in use of force and de-escalation. We aren't doing that in most places in our state. When I'm governor, we'll do it across the entire state. And we also have to recognize that community members have a major role to play in stopping killings. You know, the best thing that the police can do is to catch the last killer. Mm-hmm. And so for that, we have to make sure that the homicide units are enlarged, the special victims units are enlarged, we're solving too few homicides, we're solving too few rapes. Last time I checked, there were 3,700 untested rape kits in Maryland.
Yeah.
And part of how you do that is you shift the policing priorities. So look, the war on drugs has failed. We're gonna get you guys off of focusing on kind of low-level, nonviolent offenses. We're gonna get you back focused on first things first, and first things are homicides, rapes, and home evasions. But the other thing that you do is you embrace programs like Safe Streets. Safe Streets, or the Capital Area Violence Intervention Program here, takes men, typically, sometimes women, but typically men, who have come up on the streets, through the gangs, aged out, or decided to leave, but still have credibility, and employs them to work with victims of the last shooting to get them and their friends to decide not to retaliate. Mm-hmm. The neighborhoods that they operate in, shootings come down 26% mm-hmm. a year. Mm-hmm. Here's the thing. In Baltimore City, there are about 50 high crime, high violence neighborhoods. Throughout most of Larry Hogan's tenure, Safe Streets was only operating in 4 of those neighborhoods. He played politics with the money, withholding it. And then he put in a little bit more to expand it. But what we need to do is to scale it up completely. Yeah. When I was president of the NAACP, I worked with other places to do that. Every time that we would scale up, it would bring down the shootings.
I've seen firsthand the effect.
And you, like me, I'm sure, have had loved ones who have been shot.
Absolutely.
And when that happens, you know, it steals you.
Yeah.
And the place it brought me to is two big emotions went through me both times a family member was shot. Mm-hmm. I don't want this to happen to my family again.
Yeah.
I don't want this to happen to anybody else again.
Yeah.
And that's what guides my public safety policies.
Yeah. We've got a little over 2 minutes left. You are behind in funds. You're behind in the polls.
Yeah.
What is your, two questions to answer in 2 minutes. What is your path to victory?
Yeah.
And how do you get, you looking for, what do you say, you're looking for a million votes?
Yeah.
How do you get them?
Sure. We will win this primary the same way that we won the general election. Think about it. I lost every poll.
You mean the other way around?
A little weary here. We will win this general the same way that we won the primary. Mm-hmm. Think about it. We lost every poll. And then we won the election by 10 points. How did we do that? We built a bigger ground army. Already today, I got 5 times more organizers on the ground than the party did 4 years ago.
Than the Democratic Party did 4 years ago.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we built a bigger ground army. We've also pulled into that unions, environmental organizations, all these groups have crept up post 2016, our revolution, indivisible. Everybody's pushing out voters. One. Two, we put a positive message out there, a real plan out there. This governor has no plan. Our message resonates more deeply with the people of the state because we're ready to move forward in education, fix the healthcare crisis. That's why I've been endorsed by teachers and nurses. And what we showed last time around in the primaries, money and polls don't vote. People do. So fundamentally, this former president of the NAACP is focused on running a massive GOTV operation. That's how we will win. If you look at the polls, you might ask yourself, well, gee, how can Jealous win? Mm-hmm. If you look at the voting numbers, you say, well, how can he lose? Republicans have never gotten 900,000 people to vote for their candidate. Larry Hogan got 885,000 votes. 12 years after Bob Ehrlich got 880,000 votes. Mm-hmm. But last time we won in 2010, when my running mate, Susie Turnbull, was chair of the party, we turned up more than 1 million voters. And we did that by knocking on doors, and that's what we're doing all across the state. If folks want to volunteer, they should come to benjealous.com. We have 24 offices open right now. They're open 10 to 8 every day. People are making phone calls. They're picking up walk lists. They're turning out their neighbors. That's how we win.
You get those million people and you win. What's priority first day in? You got about 20 seconds to answer that.
Fully fund education. We have to fund education first in our budget. We have to keep the broken promise on the casino money. I'll be expected to present a budget right away, and we will stop the shortchanging of Maryland's families and children. This governor has underfunded our schools $2 billion a year. It's outrageous. It's got to stop.
Thank you so much for joining
us today.
Appreciate you.
All right. Thank you.
God bless you. Folks, and thank you, too, for joining us this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye, and may God bless you.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.